welcome to the Stroke Recovery Group. I'm so glad you're here. Welcome back to the I Care for Your Brain Stroke Recovery Group, brought to you by the Foundation of First Health. My name is Dr. Karen Sullivan. I'm a board-certified neuropsychologist and happy to be your guide throughout this stroke journey. Welcome back to rule number 7. We always like to start out with a recap of the previous rule. Rule number 6 was increase your emotional resilience. And what we focused on was the importance of having a positive mental attitude as an important tool in your toolbox for supporting your ongoing recovery. In session 6, I hope that you took my message that your stroke recovery is not just about healing your brain, but it's also about healing yourself. We talked about the importance of identifying and treating common mood symptoms after stroke with a focus on post-stroke depression. Up to 50% of stroke survivors should be diagnosed with post-stroke depression, but aren't evaluated or treated. I wanted you to focus on what was in your control and practice positive coping every day. We talked about 7 different ways to increase your emotional resilience. Stroke recovery is an emotional journey that happens in different stages. You may start in one stage, progress to the next, backtrack again, move forward. It's an ebb and it's a flow. Most people have a sense of shock and numbness immediately following their stroke, and soon after transition into feelings of denial, feeling angry, resentful. There can be a time of bargaining where you're trying to make promises with God to make it all go away. Symptoms of depression can slowly creep in. And over time, once we do the difficult work of identifying what we're really going through, grieving for the past, accepting that we can have a life of meaning and value going forward, we can finally reach that important state of acceptance. But it's a lot easier said than done. Ultimately, the focus should be on finding the meaning in this very difficult experience and finding a way to help other people walking in your same shoes through your own journey. The 7 ways that I recommended that you could increase your emotional resilience for a better recovery were 1, developing emotional awareness. I showed you the feelings wheel and encouraged you to try to find out exactly what it is you're feeling, identify that emotion and share it with a trusted loved one. 2 was viewing and conceptualizing your recovery as a challenge that you can manage. 3 is choosing to respond to stressors with action. 4 was choosing positive coping over negative coping. 5 was to keep a gratitude journal to keep your mind balanced and focused on all the things that are happening to you. 6 was to seek support through psychotherapy or medication. And 7 was finding a way to give back to others. Viewing your recovery as a challenge that you can manage is very important. How you think about the stroke and how you conceptualize how it's affected your life and the vision that you have for yourself going forward is very important and is a variable that matters in your recovery. I really want you to try to think about this in the most positive way that you can. Now we're going to go on to rule 7, supporting those that support you. And I want to start off by reminding you that a stroke didn't just happen to you. Your stroke also happened in its own unique way to the people that love and care about you. So in this rule, we're going to take a different perspective. In today's session, what I want you to do is to put yourself in your loved one's shoes. Just like you, they are living with post-traumatic stroke stress and working really hard to adjust to what's changed. The more support someone provides for you, the more likely that they are to ignore their own physical and mental health and well-being. Caregivers often have many different responsibilities, sometimes changing roles at different points in your recovery, and it's hard in a moment's notice to adjust to these different demands. Most caregivers will tell you that their care is a labor of love. Research tells us that many people find benefits in caregiving, and up to 90% of them, when asked, report that caregiving enabled them to have a more appreciative perspective on life. But make no mistake, this is hard work. 98% of stroke caregivers report one or more highly stressful problems in everyday life. Think about that, 98%, that's virtually everyone. So what I like to do in this rule is normalize how hard this is for caregivers. And it's really important for you as the survivor to understand their perspective. Research tells us that they often struggle with fatigue. Caregiving is often a 24-hour-a-day job. There are restrictions on their social life. They're not as readily able to come and go as they please. There might be no spontaneous deciding to stop for a drink with coworkers after work, to continue going to Bible study. Things change. Relationship difficulties, balancing new responsibilities. How can I continue to be a worker and a wife and a caregiver, or a husband and a father and someone who plays golf? We have to prioritize our daily events when we're a caregiver. Oftentimes, there's insufficient information on how to develop the tools and the skills to become a caregiver. Caregivers are often asked within a moment's notice to completely change their roles and responsibilities, and the truth is that I don't think we prepare them enough. They can often be uncertain about what they're doing, doubt their ability to do it. As many of you know, there are a lot of financial stress and barriers that come along with having a stroke and ongoing stroke support care. And sometimes it's a big stressor to just find the rehab or the care that your loved one needs and deserves. On the road to recovery, stroke caregivers report that the hospitalization period and the transition home, those first 4 to 6 weeks post-discharge, are the most difficult time in at least the first 2 years of caregiving. Due to the sudden onset of stroke, caregivers often take on this role with little or no preparation, leading to a sense of being ill-prepared and questioning their ability to do the job in all its demands. Caregiving is often emotionally challenging as well. Of course, it's physically challenging. It can be financially challenging. The emotional challenges are really important to talk about. Up to 60% of family caregivers report high levels of depression, anxiety, and traumatic stress. And these symptoms tend to remain chronic, unfortunately. We really need to do better for our caregivers. Caregivers tell us that they can cope better with physical impairments as opposed to changes in personality, mood, and cognition. Stroke stress from you as the survivor absolutely floats downhill. The more you struggle, the more your caregivers struggle. The higher your emotional distress, research tells us, the higher a caregiver's emotional distress. And I want you to know that because that can be a motivating factor for you to keep on with the hard work of recovery. It's not just about you, it really is about the people that love you as well. Your caregiver's psychological health matters in your recovery and is going to make a difference. So I want to share some of that research with you. When your caregiver's stress is high, it reduces their ability to provide the highest quality care for you. If someone is exhausted, if they've pulled a muscle in their back, if they are emotionally struggling, if they struggle to make ends meet financially, this limits their ability quite naturally to provide the very best care for you. So we know that when caregiver stress is high, we see worsened physical recovery, more medical issues, and more cognitive decline. There are three common challenges for caregivers that I want to go through so those of you who are listening understand that this is part of your journey as a caregiver. Number one is dealing with uncertainty. That can be tremendously difficult. Number two is managing the big anxious emotions that come along with stroke recovery from your perspective. And number three is feeling overwhelmed at managing a new life and a new role. So let's talk about all the uncertainty that can come along for the caregiver. It starts from the very beginning. There's all sorts of thoughts about what now, what am I going to do in the future, how is this person going to recover, how can they get in the house without a ramp, how am I going to move them around the house with a wheelchair that won't fit through doorways, how much are these hospital bills are going to be, and part of that is that we have experienced the stroke oftentimes as a traumatic event. It's something that happened unexpectedly, and that makes us feel that anything can happen now. Everything that's unexpected, that is unknown, can potentially be a threat to us and take our vital resources. We have big questions about what is the life that we are facing together. And for a caregiver, the biggest question seems to be, how can I do this? Managing big emotions that oftentimes are very anxious is a struggle for caregivers, especially in the beginning. You don't have any new habits. You haven't been able to develop your skills. It's really facing the great unknown. Symptoms of high anxiety that are common in caregivers include panic attacks and symptoms of hypervigilance. And what I mean by that is just feeling like you have to be on constant high alert to keep the person safe. And oftentimes caregivers tell us that they can become very focused on making sure that they recognize if another stroke happens. Oftentimes caregivers can feel guilty if the stroke symptoms from the first stroke were unrecognized. There's many stroke symptoms that people aren't familiar with, especially those that happen further back in the brain that involve balance or abnormal eye movements. And when we don't catch those, oftentimes as human beings, we blame ourselves. So the way we cope with that is by feeling like nothing's going to get past us again. This can interfere with caregiver sleep and lead to exhaustion. Caregivers, like I said before, in an instant have to manage all of their previous responsibilities with all of their new responsibilities. And oftentimes the role of advocate comes in. And again, no one teaches us how to do these things. We have to, within an instant, understand what it means to make sure we are ensuring the very best care for our loved one, making sure we're on top of medication changes, thinking about how the house has to be changed, thinking about their adjustment, that oftentimes we're not left with enough energy to think about ourselves. Caregivers are notorious for ignoring their own adjustment to focus on you. One of the things I'm very passionate about is the need to talk about how stroke and stroke recovery can affect personal relationships, including marriage. So like I keep saying, within an instant, identities and roles change. And oftentimes this is most difficult on spouses. 54% of families who've lived through a stroke tell us that there are relationship problems now. As many as 38% of couples report that they have experienced significant conflict to the point of considering divorce. That's pretty serious. Common conflicts can include difficulty with communication, survivors feeling that their loved ones are being overprotective of them or controlling them, difficulties adjusting to this new idea of a stroke survivor and a stroke caregiver. Research with couples suggests that differences between the perceptions of the survivor and the caregiver are often in conflict with each other, specifically about physical and cognitive capabilities. So what this means is one person sees it one way and the other person sees it another way. Oftentimes, one of the people in the relationship can downplay the issues and not see them as so serious, and the other person is thinking that they're very, very significant and require a lot of focused rehab. We know that this can cause interpersonal strain between partners. So again, wanting to normalize this experience for you, wanting to validate if you're going through any of this, that it really is a normal part of the caregiver journey, I want to share with you the 6 common relationship challenges that we know happen after stroke. And this is from very recent research that just came out in 2020. The first one is the struggles that can happen around communication, specifically when there are deficits in language, symptoms that relate to either expressive aphasia or receptive aphasia. Expressive aphasia being difficulty getting out your words, and receptive aphasia being difficulty understanding what is happening to you. Oftentimes there's stress on both sides. The stroke survivor, of course, desperately wants to communicate their needs and what's going on with them, and the caregiver desperately wants to understand, how can I help? And sometimes that ease of conversation, that ease of communication just isn't there, especially in the early stages. Number 2 is impairments in survivor physical function or mobility. A lot of times stroke survivors have a loss of independence and they're not able to do things in everyday life that they once did without even thinking about it. Things like brushing their teeth or dressing. Caregivers often have the best of intentions and try to intervene and provide support. But I think a very normal response from a survivor, especially in the beginning, who is just getting used to having to accept help for these things, is a little bit of irritability. It can really cause a lot of stress. There can be outbursts. People desperately know that they need the help, but it's a journey to understand how to accept the help. Number three relates to something I just said previously, differences of opinion on the value, the effectiveness, the importance of rehabilitation. I see this a lot with my patients where the caregiver feels very strongly that they should be doing more and more rehab exercises around the house. And the survivor feels that they already went to therapy, they got enough of it during the day or after the official therapy is over and they get the handouts on how to continue with therapy at home, there's maybe sometimes a struggle around not wanting to do that. This can cause a lot of relationship friction. Number four again goes back to this common theme of there's difficulty adjusting to the new identities on both sides. Perhaps on the stroke survivor side, the identity shift is going from a working person, an engineer who drove their sports car every day to work, to all of a sudden a medical patient, a stroke survivor, worse yet, a stroke victim. On the caregiver side, perhaps the person was working. They were a part of community leadership programs. They were a wife. And now this is not possible to maintain those roles as they were before. We have to help stroke survivors and their loved ones find new ways of relating, connecting, and building their lives together. Number five is changes in household responsibilities and leadership. Things like who now takes out the garbage, things like who's going to manage the checkbook. These changes are often necessary, but they're not without their struggles. And number six is a lack of support from family and friends. This is a big one. This is feeling like other people in your circle are not stepping up and helping you with all of your caregiver responsibilities. So I want you to make time for ongoing conversations about how relationships are impacted by the stroke. And remember, you're not a mind reader. It's really not within your abilities to know how other people are feeling, and we have to sit down and ask them. So how can you, the stroke survivor, help the people that are helping you? It's really as easy as these four steps: recognizing what it is they're doing for you, appreciating them, acknowledging the sacrifices that they are making and how life has changed for them, and really trying to show them as much respect as possible. Anyone who has provided you with support in this journey is worthy of your recognition and appreciation. The first people we tend to think of are our spouses, our children, but this can really extend to doctors, therapists, your aide that comes to the house, family, and friends. There are many ways to show your gratitude for the gifts of support, big and small. What I want to focus on now are three different ways to do it: the power of words, the power of touch, and the power of deed. If you can, use your words to show your appreciation. You can either speak them or write them to let someone know how their support has helped you. Be specific and as genuine as you can. Think how you would have felt if not for their support and let them know how much they have meant to you. If you're not the card writing type, you can find a store-bought card that captures your feelings. Or if you go into the Interactive Stroke Recovery Guide on page 75, we've actually provided you with a couple of these cards. These can be for your therapist or people closer to you in your life. The cards say things like, "Knowing that you care is my best medicine," "My brain and I could not have done this without you," "Thank you for making a difference in my recovery," and "Your love and support are appreciated." So just get in there, cut them out, put your name on the back, and give them to the person. The next one is the power of appropriate touch. Appropriate touch releases those feel-good chemicals like oxytocin, which can help strengthen trust and reduce those brain-hurting stress chemicals that we talk about, adrenaline and cortisol. So take a moment or a few moments to connect physically in a way that is respectful for the type of relationship you have with the person. A hug or a hand-on-hand touch is the universal gesture of gratitude. Then we have the power of deed. This is where you can buy someone a thoughtful gift. That's absolutely wonderful. Themes that focus on self-care and pampering are always appreciated. Just think about what that person enjoys and find something affordable to give them from your heart to theirs. Like I said before, we really need to do better by our caregivers. Psychological therapies post-stroke, when they are offered and delivered, are often focused either on the stroke survivor or on the caregiver, with little inclusion of their relationship. In 2017, the American Heart Association recommended that in psychological interventions, we include both person and caregiver. I would love to see more and more of these programs come to life. Psychological interventions for caregivers must be integrated into stroke rehabilitation. Do you agree with me? We need to improve the caregiver experience because we know it helps them, it improves patient quality of life, well-being, and we really need to provide skill development, education on how to become a caregiver. For some, it comes more naturally than others. We really need to make a priority the supportive problem solving of our caregivers. Way too many caregivers come to an impasse in their caregiving road and just don't know who to ask to help get them over the hurdle. I want to share with you some tips for caregivers because in my experience, they are always wanting to know how they can increase the support and the love and the interventions that they're giving to their loved one. So these are some ways that those who support you can help in your recovery. The first thing that I've found to be most helpful is to become an excellent record keeper. What do I mean by this? This means getting a binder, collecting the hospital records, the brain scans, the discharge plans, changes in medication, and follow-up appointments. When in doubt, get it in writing. Collect all of these important papers in a binder and bring it around with you to different therapies and medical appointments. So much of care coordination involves the sharing of personalized brain health information. I want you to educate yourself about your loved one's unique stroke, and that's exactly what you're doing by participating in this stroke recovery group. I want you to get comfortable in the role of advocate. People who have strong family advocates do better. I want you to ask clarifying questions in doctor's appointments. Don't let the doctors speak over your head. There's no shame in asking them to break it down, to make it easier to understand, to ask them to repeat themselves. I want you to lovingly encourage your person to do their rehab exercises daily. There's different ways that different people respond to being asked to do something. You know your person very well. You can tell them to do things directly. You can suggest that they do things. You can give a reward for doing things. Whatever works for your person, I want you to try to put that into a daily schedule. Providing reminders around the house can be a very supportive way of keeping the recovery on track and really supporting them in their independence. Whatever it is that they can do on their own, we want you to be right there to make sure things are safe, but over time, we really want you to give as much over to that person as they can safely handle. I want you to try to help your loved one return to their hobbies or interests in any way that they can now within the limits of their abilities. We often talk about this. Meet the recovery where it is. Please don't just abandon something that you used to love because you can't do it in the same way that you did it before. This is often a question I get from caregivers who have a loved one struggling with communication. There's a feeling of how much should I help? Should I give them the word? And what I often recommend is if it's a normal time of day and fatigue is relatively low and hunger is relatively low and you see the person struggling, ask them if you can help. If people say yes to accepting our help, it's not as easy to get mad at us when we do jump in and provide a solution. However, if it's later in the day, you're finding the person is really struggling, they're tired, it's, you know, late at night, then it's a good time to perhaps just give the answer. If the person doesn't appreciate that, you can apologize and again go back to the asking. But what we don't want to do is just jump in and make everything easier for the person. Sometimes that's what our heart tells us to do, but part of this rehab is we have to have the person constantly stretching to do more and more for themselves on their own. I want you to be very mindful of continuing to include your loved one in social exchanges. This is a big one in the brain health community. It's really true that in group conversations, folks with brain health issues can be left behind. Things are very fast, retrieval is very quick for people who aren't struggling with a brain health challenge, and very often this can feel rejecting to our loved ones with a brain injury. We really want to make sure we make time to include them, to get their reaction, to make sure that they're actively participating in group discussions. The next one is to really make your loved one's laughter and their experience of joy a priority, even if it's only for a moment. Remember, when we have those joyful experiences, when we're spontaneously amused or find something funny, it's not just a feeling in the moment. We're releasing those feel-good chemicals that we know support brain injury recovery. Let them know that it's also okay to cry. We can't prop people up and force them to be positive all the time. That wouldn't be authentic. What we want to do is invite them to have genuine emotional experiences and to have them know that we're here for it. We validate it and we care. We also want to be very careful to not let people wallow in it too much. We want to give the proper, respectful time for people to have their emotional experience, but sometimes with stroke, those perseverative thought patterns can creep in, where that broken record goes over and over and over again. So a good rule of thumb is we want to give, you know, a nice half hour to talk about the darker sides, the deeper sides, to let someone fully express themselves. And after we feel like they've really had a good chance to get it out, distracting the person, go on to doing something that is fully engaging is often a great idea. When the time is right and you feel like your loved one has come a long way in their own journey and they're ready to maybe have enough resource within themselves to give back, I really want you to try to find some type of community outreach that's appropriate for your person. I promise it will be an important part of their healing journey, and that way they're also giving back to the larger community of stroke survivors out there. I want to make sure you understand that the Stroke Family Warm Line is something that is available to you by the American Heart and Stroke Association. This is a hotline that connects stroke survivors and their families with the team member who can provide support and information from someone who has been there. So remember earlier I talked about the impasses that caregivers can have where they just don't know what to do with a specific problem or deficit. You can call this number, 1-888-4-STROKE. That's 1-888-478-7653. They're available to answer the phone Monday through Friday, 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. Central Time. So concluding rule number 7, this is our self-empowerment statement. The well-being of my caregivers is important to me. I will show them my appreciation often. I hope that you will join me next time for rule number 8. This is when we're going to talk about the importance of acknowledging your trauma. We're going to talk about post-traumatic stroke disorder. I want you to really understand how that might be affecting you because it is a barrier to your recovery. Thank you guys so much for joining me, and I'll look forward to seeing you next time. Bye-bye.